Welcome to Dechert's Committed Capital, where PE leaders open their playbooks to discuss today's PE trends.
Hello, everyone. My name is Thiha. I'm a partner in Dechert's private funds practice. In this episode, we will be looking at the use of continuation funds as part of private equity secondary transactions. I'm joined today by David Lee, Managing Director at Kroll, and Michael Tose, co-founder and partner of Columna Capital. If I may introduce Michael and David in a bit more detail, if you can just introduce yourselves and what your firms do, please.
Absolutely, Thiha. Thank you. My name is Michael Tose. I am a co-founder and a partner at Columna Capital. We're a private equity group based in London, Luxembourg and Switzerland, and we focus on growth opportunities in the lower mid-market, predominantly in Southern Europe.
Thank you, Michael. David?
Yes, thanks for having me on, Thiha, and appreciate the opportunity to be here with you today. So I'm a managing director in the Transaction Opinions Group at Duff & Phelps. And just quickly on our rebranding. So Duff & Phelps acquired Kroll in 2018. And in that transaction, we added 900 risk management professionals. And we expanded our capabilities in cybersecurity, governance, and investigations. So the company is now unified under the Kroll name. However, given the reputation that we've built over decades in our opinions practice, and given that we are the market leader in this space, we've retained the Duff & Phelps name for our opinions group. I've been based in the New York office, but I'll be actually relocating to London in a couple months to spearhead the growth of our opinions practice in Europe. Our opinions practice has over 50 dedicated professionals. It's comprised of a group of senior managing directors that have, on average, over 25 plus years with the firm. We deliver independent, high quality, and objective financial advice and opinions that decision makers like trustees, fiduciaries, and limited partner advisory committees in the context of these related fund transactions can rely upon as part of their decision making process.
Thank you, David. Thank you. So, I can say that for the three of us on this podcast, last year was a very busy year for secondaries deals, particularly GP-led secondaries. But we also saw the private debt GP-led secondaries market unlock in Q3, Q4 of last year. And anecdotally, at least, the number of private debt secondaries now match or may even exceed the number of private equity secondaries deals coming to the market. In this podcast, we'll focus more on the private equity GP-led secondaries because that's a more mature segment. I'm going to ask David, if I may, if you could just give a brief macro overview of the secondaries market last year.
Yeah, sure. So, and our insight is based on several reports that have been published by secondary advisors in the space. But 2021, there was a record level of a little over $130 billion in total secondaries volume, and that compared to just $60 billion in 2020. Out of that $130 billion, roughly $70 billion was from GP-led secondary recap activity, which was, I believe, over 150% increase over 2020 levels. More than 100 of these processes came to market in 2021, driven primarily by high levels of available dry powder and pent-up buyer demand. These GP-led secondaries, they continue to grow their overall share of the secondaries market. In 2021, they represented a little over 50% of total secondaries volume. And people refer to this as a shift to a kind of a quote-unquote new normal, where GP-led volume is now on par with and will most likely exceed LP-led transactions going forward. Maybe only 4 to 5 years ago, GP-leds represented only maybe a quarter of the overall secondaries market. You know, you hear that the volume growth is, you know, a lot of sponsors are using these transactions. They've become mainstream in the private equity world. And as their investment thesis becomes validated, you see that limited partners are now more familiar and comfortable with them. And so they really have become a mainstream exit alternative for sponsors, best companies, and trophy assets. In 2021, about, I believe, 85% of GP-led transaction volume was in the form of continuation funds, and single asset continuation funds comprised almost 50% of total GP-led volume. Multi-asset deals were not too far behind. The other typical forms of GP-leds include tender offers, but the volume in those deals has been declining over the last several years with the growth in these continuation funds. And maybe just one other trend to point out is that these continuation funds are now being formed for increasingly younger assets, meaning that the assets may have been only acquired maybe 3 to 4 years ago by the sponsor, but the asset has performed well. It's already made a 2x return. There's still potential upside. And so, you know, the GPs would rather hold on to these than sell them to another PE sponsor. And so we obviously see this trend continuing in the future.
So just to add to that, you know, our own observation is that the market dynamics have changed, you know, quite considerably, particularly in the last year and a half. And two aspects of that have been the increased number of new entrants into the market, GPs doing secondary transactions for the first time, other well-established GPs adding secondaries strategies to their existing portfolio of strategies, and also the likes of sovereign wealth funds and others entering this market. So, question for Michael. So if you were a GP looking to sponsor a GP-led secondary for the first time, what would you say, you know, would be the 4 or 5 key issues to get right in order to successfully execute a transaction like this?
I think the first point to make here is that the sponsor really needs to have a very credible rationale for this type of transaction. Columna, we completed several of these types of transactions, and you need to have a very clear plan for further value creation over the next cycle of the particular asset in question. But I think that if you have that rationale and you have the willingness or desire on the part of the management team of the portfolio to maintain an association with the sponsor, this really gives you a very strong framework within which to start the dialogue with investors. And what I would say to any sponsor looking at this potential transaction is to maintain a very high level of transparency and fairness with existing investors. So really inform them very early on in the process. Clearly, everyone's has a different relationship with their LPs, but we have a particularly tight relationship with our key LPs who all sit on the LPAC of all of our structures. And I think what we do is they would be informed very early on in our thinking about what we were looking to achieve and what we were considering. We would keep them updated regularly on the status of a particular transaction. And, you know, we would be very clear that there would be rollover rights given to those existing LPs on the sell side. And we would make sure that all investors had access to the same information. So that I would group together as a sort of transparency point. Other pieces of advice I think would be make sure you've got the right advisors, and you know clearly it's very important to have the right advisor on the legal side to navigate clearly the different issues of conflict, but also on the transaction mechanics and the structuring the transaction. In some cases, you'll need a financial advisor that can also help support the fundraising, but also on the transaction itself, where you may want to split those two mandates between someone who has, you know, a credible GP-led fundraising or fundraising support group, and then have a very asset-specific financial advisor to support you on generating materials for the transaction. And, you know, in some cases, you will need a fairness opinion, and clearly you need to have the right advisor there who has a credible track record in the particular industry of the asset that you're looking at. And then the other, the last point I'd probably make is that is timetable. I would say that if you think it's going to take 6 months, it'll take a year. So really, it always takes longer. So just bear that in mind, because it always does.
Thank you. Thanks, Michael. Switching over to David. So from your perspective, Kroll's perspective, when, you know, I'm picking up on some of what Michael has said, what would you say are, you know, some of the key issues or trends that are becoming more prominent when GPs try to execute these sort of transactions? And I'm thinking, you know, for example, price discovery and how the price discovery process has evolved recently. You mentioned earlier single assets versus multi-asset portfolios or deals coming on the market. Could you share with us, you know, some of your thoughts on what these issues are and how you can navigate them?
Yeah, sure, Thiha. So the use of these dual track processes, they continue to grow in the GP-led market. So this is where the GP will first run a process to sell a minority stake in the asset to a new third-party sponsor. And then that valuation is subsequently used to set the price for the syndication in the continuation fund. One of the reports published by the secondary advisors indicate that the most common method of price discovery remains the kind of the multi-stage auction process, which was used about 70% of the time in continuation fund transactions last year. But then the other 30%, the price was determined by third parties buying a minority piece in the asset. And these dual track processes were very rare, you know, just a few years ago. We were engaged recently by a large U.S. blue chip sponsor to render a fairness opinion in one of these dual track processes. The sponsor was looking to sell a roughly $4 billion interest in a highly coveted asset. So the sponsor started off by selling about $1.5 billion of the $4 billion to another new third party kind of brand name sponsor. And the remaining $2.5 billion is being syndicated in the continuation fund at the price that was paid by the third party sponsor. What's interesting in this deal is because it's so large, if the remaining $2.5 billion can't be fully syndicated in the continuation fund, the sponsor would actually consider taking up that difference as a direct investment from its next flagship fund. And so we see this, you know, this dynamic not only in continuation fund transactions, but also in the context of, you know, traditional fund-to-fund transfers where fund one is selling an asset to fund two. The GP hires an investment bank to run a process to sell a minority stake, and then again that price is used for the transfer of the asset from fund one to fund two. In these instances, we're often engaged by both the selling and the buying fund to render an opinion to both sides. While clearly this is price discovery and price validation through a third party investment, it doesn't eliminate the conflict at the end of the day, and that the GP is still on both sides of the trade. You know, perhaps the third party sponsor might have paid a little more in a traditional M&A sale for the whole company. And so we still think, you know, it's best practice and good corporate governance to obtain an opinion in these conflict situations.
David, your points are very well made. I think I'd probably add two more from a GP's perspective. You need to be in a position to make a very substantial commitment on the buy side as a GP in these transactions. So you will be looking to invest, I would have thought, north of 70% of your net proceeds derived from a particular transaction. That isn't a rule, but in our cases, we've done at least that, if not more, in these. And that's one way of really mitigating the conflict.
Thanks, Michael. So just staying with you, Michael, on a couple of other things. So, you know, we've experienced these transactions where GPs have put the asset up for auction, or sometimes just had a bilateral negotiation with a single buyer. And as David also mentioned, you know, where the deals are pretty big in size, there's syndication, and possibly, you know, a member of that syndicate might be a new fund that the GP is also sponsoring. So perhaps you could talk a little bit about, you know, the differences between auctions and bilateral negotiations and some of the challenges that you face, you know, when you're doing a stapled secondary as well.
We've been involved in both scenarios, and very recently. The auction route clearly has the very significant advantage that it does deliver price discovery in a very very transparent manner. So it's a major conflict mitigant. At the same time, you should be aware that as a GP, that you will be subject to the types of due diligence that perhaps a primary group would apply to you, because they don't know you. So this is a new investor, and they will need to carry out their sort of full sort of GP due diligence. I think the difference would be that an auction will typically take more time, and there is a sort of more elaborate and more complicated process to run, and which is why it is very important to have the right advisor to be able to coordinate that type of transaction structure. On the bilateral side, to the extent that you are primarily dealing with your own investors, and in our experience, most of these investors will actually be investing out of different pockets. So you will have the same institution will be on the buy and sell side, but they will be investing out of different pockets. So you might have a bilateral process, but in actual fact, there'll be a full underwrite by the investor from a newly raised pocket of capital. And that in itself will also give you some price discovery flavor, although there isn't a formal auction. You know, a large investor will be stepping up through a completely new pocket of capital, and will be doing a very significant amount of work to diligence the opportunity. I think in a bilateral process, you will always need a fairness opinion. I'm not suggesting that in an auction you won't either, but you will definitely need one then. It's very sort of transaction specific, and there are challenges and sort of differences in each one. But I think it's important to really have the right support and the right plan and the right timetable in order to be able to affect either route.
On the staple side, so yes. How was your experience on that?
It's mixed, really, and again it sort of depends a little bit on the fundraising environment sort of more broadly. Clearly at the moment the market is extremely crowded. Almost every sponsor globally is coming back to their LPs asking for new money. So I think that the stapled route can put off some investors. You may lose an investor if you're acquiring a staple. And again, it's sort of a measure of competitive tension and also the availability of capital. So we've had situations where it's been easier and others which have been more difficult.
Thank you. Thanks. So, David, when you guys are asked to do a fairness opinion and or a independent valuation, can you just give our listeners an idea of, you know, what the process involves, how long it takes, what the GPs should have ready to make the process smoother, and you know, perhaps maybe starting with, as we were talking earlier on price discovery, you know, NAV of their assets, and you know what you guys look out from your perspective in order to deliver you know, a fairness opinion and or evaluation, you know, efficiently and smoothly.
Yeah, sure, Thiha. So from our standpoint, it's important to start early, obviously. A secondary process creates lots of demands on the schedules of the deal team, management of the portfolio companies. We always strive to be as user-friendly as possible, and engaging with us earlier on, you know, gives us enough runway to complete our due diligence and be additive to the overall process. And in these transactions, just in terms of, you know, the engagement setup, it's typical for our opinion to be addressed to the fund that's selling the asset, as well as the general partner of the fund. So the fund and the GP of the fund are the engaging clients. But in the use of advice section of our engagement letter, we do have specific language that allows for disclosure of our opinion to LPs who are members of the LPAC. And so this assists the fund essentially in fulfilling its governance obligations under the fund documents. So as I mentioned before, you know, ideally we're brought in during the earlier rounds of the bidding process, and you know, we'll have a few weeks to complete our diligence and conduct our analysis. Typically, a data room will have been set up containing all the information that we'll need for our analysis. Most importantly, the business plan for the portfolio company, historical financial statements, and you know, a SIM is usually put together by the secondary advisor. And just in terms of kind of the timeline, since LPAC approval and consent is typical in these transactions, we're usually working towards delivery of our opinion when the final deal terms are submitted to the LPAC, and at which time an LPAC meeting is put on the calendar, and that's when our materials are requested. So going to price discovery, you mentioned, and the emphasis on NAV, pricing tends to be in a pretty tight band around that NAV in these auctions. But there could be pitfalls to using this reference date NAV. I mean, the NAV could be stale, as you know, it was mentioned that these are complex transactions, and they have very long completion times, sometimes extending for 6 months or longer. So the underlying value of the portfolio company could have changed over that reference date NAV. You know, one other thing we've observed is that some GPs take into consideration the performance of the fund in aggregate, and so they may be reluctant to fully mark up some of their outperforming assets. And so, you know, that resulting NAV, that quarterly NAV, which is primarily used for financial reporting purposes, you know, it could deviate materially from intrinsic value. I mean, someone could argue the pricing in this deal is 100% of NAV, and so LPs are getting a pretty good deal. But you know, if the investment was marked at a clearly supportable 10 times EBITDA, you know, based on where public comps are trading, as opposed to a more conservative 8.5 times that the GP has it marked at, then, you know, obviously 100% of NAV at 10 times is a better deal than 100% at 8.5 times. So, you know, it goes into kind of the optics of pricing around that NAV. So really our analysis is a fundamental analysis, you know, cash flow analysis, market multiples, and it kind of detethers that deal price from NAV. And we think it provides, you know, valuable information to the LPAC and to the LPs. And it just our review process, we have a standard and well-defined process for both the analysis and just risk management in general. It's a two-stage committee review process. The first one is an in-depth technical review of the analysis, including discount rates, market multiples. And the second review is a formal senior review and approval committee, and that's chaired by our firm's GC and chief risk officer. When all is said and done, at least 5 out of the 14 managing directors in our opinions practice will have reviewed and approved any opinion that we deliver.
Michael, obviously you've been doing a number of GP-leds recently. What would you say are the main differences between a GP-led secondary transaction versus other traditional exit routes like M&A trade sales and IPOs? And why is it that in some cases a GP-led is better, in your opinion, compared to the other alternatives?
Absolutely. Thiha, when you come to the end of a particular investment cycle, depending on the maturity of the particular management team, and what I say that is this a management team that's already been through several private equity cycles already, who's looking to retire, maybe there are other particular motivations, or maybe the management team is keen to remain with the management team, but also the sponsor itself. And I think in our cases, we've seen that at the time of considering an exit, there's been a really strong desire on the part of the sort of C-suite or senior managers, and in some cases, significant owners of the business to continue what has been a very successful partnership. And with us, with Columna, and rather than run the risk of an unknown quantity with a new sponsor. And in some cases, that new sponsor will rely more heavily on leverage as a driver of returns. So I think that if you're in a situation where management is looking for a transition in some cases, but also looking for stability within the business and within the capital structure, they will be highly supportive of a GP-led solution rather than a traditional M&A route where clearly you have no idea who you will end up in bed with from a management perspective. I think from a GP's perspective, you could feel that there is a really strong sort of transactional rationale for continuing to sponsor a particular opportunity. So you may just see a really highly visible growth, a really strong alignment with management, and feel that now is not the right time to sell the business. And it may be that the constraints of the fund structure in which the asset is held, you know, has coming to its end, and you need to find a solution. And so I think that is a highly important motivation for a GP to look for a GP-led continuation solution. In all honesty, it can also create momentum for other fundraising. You may be able to offer your investors a very interesting piece in a continuation, and at the same time catalyze new investors to come in and existings into a new primary structure. We touched upon the staples question earlier on. And lastly, from a GP's perspective, I think that these solutions can provide the end of a fund and crystallize incentives, and you know, which a significant proportion will be rolled into the new structure and or any other funds which are being raised at the same time by the sponsor. But it is a solution to provide the end to a particular fund structure in question. And I think from an LP's perspective, speaking from experience that we've had, our LPs have often been extremely keen to maintain exposure to an asset. And you know, we've been talking all about conflict mitigation and other things. It's not just the GP that will be supportive of from an early stage of this type of continuation situation. LPs can be very supportive and actively discuss the options and what might be possible, because they want to maintain exposure, they want to roll over and bring in new vehicles, and in some cases they want to very materially increase their exposure to a particular asset. So these solutions can be good for both management, GPs and LPs together.
Thank you very much. Thank you. That's very interesting indeed. Unfortunately, we've come up to time. So I guess my concluding comment is I do feel that a GP-led secondary transaction is now accepted part of a GP's toolkit when looking at its funds and liquidity solutions for its LPs. I certainly believe that activity levels will remain robust for this year and next year onwards. So hopefully the audience has gleaned some interesting information from this podcast. For more information or to listen to previous Committed Capital episodes, please visit us on Dechert.com. And also please remember to subscribe to your favorite podcast platform so that you can listen to our next episode, which will cover financial services M&A. So with that, I'd like to thank David, Michael, for your invaluable time today and your insights. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you, Thiha.
Thank you, Thiha.